Welcome back to Politics Watch. This is Serpy. Now today I'm going to talk about a Klansman that you would have heard me mention many times. His street name was Sci-Fi, but his original name, or his government name, is Orrin Malcolm. Now, the reason why this individual is a key member of the whole Klansman story is because he played a major role in helping black man become the, or well, not become, but to establish his position as leader of Klansman. Don't worry, I'm going to get into all that. But let me give you a brief background on Orrin Malcolm, aka Sci-Fi. Now, Sci-Fi was not originally from Spanish Town. He actually come from South St. Andrew, right? And, you know, when he was young, he was one of those youths who was troubled from he was young, right? So he ended up in a Spanish Town. Now, when he ended up at Spanish Town, he ended up over on Lauriston side. This is where things started to get interesting for the young Sci-Fi, who was already interested in the badness, right? Now, he started out with just a little one pop, right? You know, back then, guns weren't as easily sourced. He man youths like Brasco, BB, Stone, right, Leroon, all of them start making them one pop and decide to touch the streets, right? And then go over places like Ensom and then place the, you know, start rap people with them one pop, because again, back then they were not as established, right? They never have access to no real gun, so I saw them start out young. Again, remember I did the videos previously about one pop, and now if Jamaican youths who really want bad, if them can't get access to a real gun, them simply just make a one pop and touch the street, right? So Sci-Fi was one of those youths. But all of that was child's play. Eventually, Sci-Fi would finally get his chance to play a more serious role in the organization. And this happened when he started to link with man like Humphrey, Cracker, City Puss, and the Monday, right? So Humphrey was a big man of the system, right? And Humphrey did actually have his own, you can think of it almost like a gang within a gang, right? And they used to call themselves Renegade, right? So Humphrey was the one who really started to oversee Sci-Fi's transition into what I would call serious badness, right? He used to run around, and you know, Demi used to work with for City Post, as I mentioned before in previous videos. There's a man who is a serious killer from them time there, and Sci-Fi was able to, you know, think of it like a student just watching the bigger man do certain things and learn certain things just from being around people like Humphrey and Cracker. But eventually Humphrey and his renegade thing got out of hand, right? He managed to cross Bulby, and you already know who is the biggest killer of Klansman, and that is other Klansman, right? So Humphrey crossed Bulby, and as you can imagine, he paid with his life. And even the name Renegade died with him, right? Because a lot of people think that the one done thing started with Tesha Miller. No, it was actually Bulby who was the first person to say, listen, one done, where I say, right? Because back then they used to have these different, used to have, like, as I said, groups like Renegade, and Bulby was making it clear, listen, there is no Renegade, right? There's just one done, right? So now Humphrey's gone, right? And his Renegade team is gone, and that Renegade team had people like Papu. You've heard me mention Smokey and Hezzy already before, right? Lukey D and them and they, right? But anyway, Sci-Fi is no longer under Humphrey's local team. But you hear the name Sci-Fi, and I know most people, right? I'm assuming here most people are aware of the channel known as Sci-Fi. Back in the day when they have cable, you know about Sci-Fi, you know, so anything that come from Sci-Fi, anything that show up on that channel is normally about some kind of horror movie or some kind of space show or dopey show or alien show, you know, something extraordinary, something that is out of this world, right? So how did Orrin Malcolm end up get a name like that? Actually, it's because he went on an operation, right, and he carried out an act that was so gruesome that it stunned the other Klansman, and they decided that was the name he was supposed to get. What was the act? Well, Sci-Fi them go for kill a man, and the man a run, and the man try jump over a fence, and the fence had all kind of barbed wire and metal pole and them thing there. And as the man try jump over the fence to escape from Sci-Fi, him drop in at the fence and the barbed wire and get stuck. So what did Orrin Malcolm do? At the time everybody called him Orrin. Sci-Fi decided, you know what, he wasn't going to shoot the man, even though it would be very easy for him to do that, because by this point the man stuck between the fence and the whole heap of wire. Sci-Fi proceeded to hold the man, and he pushed and pulled him in a sawing motion. And when you ever see somebody saw a piece of wood yet, the back and forth motion, that is what sci-fi did with the man. He pushed, pull, pushed, pull, in the wire, in the fence. As you can imagine, flesh, wire, tear up. It was an act that was so gruesome. Stone said, listen, this youth named Sci-Fi. By the time Sci-Fi done push and pull the man through the fence and the barbed wire, the man's seed bag tear out, whole of him skin off, him foot gone, right, whole of him guts, all kind of things tear up. As you can imagine, it was a gruesome sight. And that is how Orrin Malcolm earned the name Sci-Fi, right? An individual that was so vicious even then that it made other Klansmen go, no, this youth isn't normal. And I've said it many times, when you can stand out in an organization like Klans, you know you have some serious, serious issues, right? So I just wanted to make people know how you got the name Sci-Fi. But it got even worse. You might be thinking to yourself, but what do you mean it get worse? Remember I said originally Sci-Fi was really running around in Humphrey and them, and they, Sci-Fi end up get a new sensei. Remember, he was already gruesome. He was already known for doing extraordinary acts. Guess who would come along and end up become is basically local Don? James Hines, the head removal specialist. So now James Hines, Richard Lariston, and all of them in him team, right? He had Scott in him team, he had Sci-Fi in him team. So now Sci-Fi is working a part of James' team. And James Hines now start to teach Sci-Fi how to truly, truly push the boundaries on what can be considered sin. Because as I said, there is no reason. Some of the things that James Hines used to do, it defies any kind of rationale, even by criminal standards. Even the other 87 of them, even other Klansmen were completely mind blown. James Hines was the man who used to go up on ops and make other Klansmen vomit when they see what him do his victims. If you haven't seen that video, go check it out. So Sci-Fi is now under James' wing and he's learning from James. And straight away, Sci-Fi demonstrated that he was a very good student when it comes on to learning about carrying out gruesome acts. James Hines would teach them the theory and then Sci-Fi would go carry out the practical side of it. Right, James Hines rated him highly, right? Because some people, as I said, struggled with carrying out certain acts of brutality. It's one thing if you take a gun and shoot somebody, One thing to shoot somebody 5-10 times and then run gamble your business. But to stick around and start to remove head and remove this and remove that, a lot of people aren't cut out for it, even inside a Klansman. Sci-Fi wasn't one of those people. Sci-Fi was very comfortable, right, carrying out very, very gruesome acts. But just like Humphrey, James Hines end up drop out as well. So now Sci-Fi found himself in a situation where again he was leaderless, right? Because as I said, even though you don't know Tesha was the overall Don, locally it was James Hines was the person who they were reporting to. So after police killed James Hines, guess what? Sci-Fi was no longer a boy like when Humphrey died. Sci-Fi was now a big man in the area. When it comes on to 87 lifestyle, people know him, he have a name, he's feared, he's my own man. So he ends up becoming one of the top men in that era, alongside other people such as Crab, Scott, and their man there, right? By now you should have seen the other videos and know who those individuals are, right? So Sci-Fi, Scott, Crab, and them man, they really a whole long over Lariston side. And you probably remember me mentioning Sci-Fi name from the Tredegar Park operation. Sci-Fi was there. Scott was there. As a matter of fact, just to touch briefly on Tredegar Park, when they were carrying out the operation, right before them go, and they were starting to get out, right, people were coming from all over, biker pull up in all different locations. As I said, they had rounded up some of the most ruthless killers to send a very loud message to Tredegar Park. Now, when the man them a group up from all boat, man a pull up on bike, right, all the pillion have gone, right, and there was a legend inside a Klansman where people were talking about a chrome AK-47, right? Enough people in the Klans did that hear about chrome AK, but nobody never did see it. For the Tredegar Park operation, that was the first time the man them actually see the chrome AK-37. turn up to go on that operation, right? So Sci-Fi go over there, and you already know there is no way something like that could miss him. But even apart from Tredegar Park, Sci-Fi, Scott, James Hines, and them man they used to regular just pass through Tredegar Park and just kill people left, right, and center. It wasn't just James Hines who make people have sleepless nights when they hear him name, right? Sci-Fi was one of them Monday, Scott was one of them Monday, a youth named Duck was one of them Monday, right? Them people used to terrorize Tredegar Park, right? Even to this day, right? Those names just synonymous with brutality. And speaking about Tredegar Park, one of the last messages that was delivered to the man named before they go over there on that fateful night and kill 8 people was that, and I quote, "The black dog said don't leave until at least 15 dead," end quote. That was the direct message given to the 87s who were about to proceed into Tredegar Park. You might be wondering to yourself, what that mean? What do you mean the black dog said don't leave before at least 18 dead? Who is the black dog? The black dog refers to Andre Blackman Bryan, who at this point was also in jail with Tesha Miller, right? Tesha Miller that jail, Blackman that jail, right? But when Tredegar Park was going down, at the time, they were not yet at odds, right? So they were on the same page, right? And they both agreed that Tredegar Park needed to be taught a lesson. There were supposed to be 15 people who got killed in Tredegar Park. Them only left with 8, and the 8 of them left with had absolutely nothing to do with badness, right? But I guess them decide say them now left without killing somebody, and that is how them end up start go house to house. If you haven't seen that video, go check it out. I did an entire video on the Tredegar Park operation, one of the most, well, in my opinion, the most evil act Klansman has ever carried out. But I mentioned Blackman for a reason, because this is Sci-Fi played a major role, arguably the biggest role, in helping to establish and cement Blackman as the leader of the organization. But go and sit by your Milo T or your Cersei Bush. Don't worry, we're going to get into the full transition as to how Blackman and Tesha end up split up and the war between the two of them jump off and the role the Sci-Fi playing in all of this. But before I go into that, let me continue to just give you some more information about this individual known as Sci-Fi. Right now, Sci-Fi had an interesting trait. He was very, very patient. See, anytime Sci-Fi was given orders to go for somebody, he wouldn't just wait till him get no call, say him down the road, or make a kerosene, go carry a man on a corner. No, Sci-Fi used to sleep on people's roof. Sci-Fi used to get orders, say listen, go for the man there, and he would go down there, go to the person house, sleep on them roof for days on end, right? He would literally stay up on the roof and don't come off. Right, carry everything you need up there, food, everything, and he would stay there until the person come home and he would kill them. If Sci-Fi believed you were giving the police information, he would crawl along to the people in house at night time and sleep under them window and cock him ears and listen if nobody attacked the police. And this made him completely different to the other 87s, right? Remember in the Preke Boy video I said Preke Boy in another life could have possibly been a member of the JDF? Well, Sci-Fi and his traits could end up could have also been a good candidate considering how he operated. As I said, this youth was a big fan of reconnaissance, right? He would target his victims, lay in wait, no matter how long it take, and him now move until he come home. So enough people end up losing them life because them get a day or two and say, well, you know, may you say my look for me, but it's been 2 days now, so he must gone. Right, then every time they go home, guess who them run into? Sci-Fi. He was also known for walking through the community with his rifle across his back, writing matic in him and him don't care about nothing, right? He ended up becoming very powerful because, as I said, because of the type of acts he was committing, not only was he at 87, but he was feared by other 87s inside his own gang, right? And that right there is the most apex when it comes on to being a brutal gang member, when even your own gang members are afraid of you. Something that only people like James Hines and Hodges and Bad from Anemide, only them type of you they get feared by their own gang. So now let's go into the split between Blackman and Tesha. Because remember, originally, Tesha Miller handed over leadership to Blackman while both of them were in prison. And this was really a steady transition, right? It's not like it was a quick and abrupt thing, right? So from maybe late 2010 into early 2011, black man started to have more and more say within the system, right? So anything the man them want, they might have to go through black man, right? If people link Tesha, both of the bodies, Tesha would say, listen, talk to black man, right? So it wasn't like, say, black man originally stole power, right, through any kind of force. It was handed to him by Tesha Miller. So now suddenly the man named Ula take talk from Tesha, know what you say, a black man had him done. Now that alone troubled certain people in the streets, because enough people didn't actually check for black man like that. People did rate Tesha, people did rate Nevada Hodges. As a matter of fact, enough people did want Hodges to become the Don, right? Because, you know, Hodges was like a in the street 87. He was known, he was rated highly within the system, right? Black man never had the same reputation when it comes down to being a killer like Nevada Hodges, right? But Tesha Miller did rate black man. But the reason why I bring up Hodges is because sometimes people try and bring in Hodges into the conversation as if Hodges was battling for power in Klansman, like Hodges was trying to steal the leadership of Klansman. But that is not the case, right? But don't worry, that's going to come in a separate video. This video is going to be the remake of the Nevada Hodges video, because the first one I did, YouTube take it down and give my channel a strike, right? So I'm going to have to redo that video. Don't worry, it will come out in time, right? So now, black man is running the system, right? Some people decide to deny it at all, because the way how black man was doing things was different from how Tesha was doing things. For example, black man disagreed that certain places supposed to get extorted, right? Certain local wholesale and certain local places, black man was saying, listen, in the medicine to bother extorting place them, we could focus on the taxi and the bus them, because we don't want the business place them to get too afraid and go shut down, and then the business now go on, so that means the customers now come, and that means in a taxi now make the money. That was the angle black man was coming from. And from a business perspective, to be honest, that completely makes sense, right? Because he was saying, listen, the last thing we want is the business to shut down, right? Because at the business, they might attract the crowd, and when the crowd come, at them time, the taxi man make money, bus man make money, etc. But some of the 87s, they moved used to the old style, where them just extort every living thing where them can see. Then they just say, listen, we're not taking a talk from this brother. Who does he think he is? Tesha Maidan. And one of the main youths, them Ula said this, was a 87 by the name of Dowan. Right, and Dowan was rolling with another youth you heard me talk about named Demar. He's currently behind bars, right? Demar, aka the Baby Killer. Right. Now, this youth, Dowan, he was one of the people them who helped to trigger off the whole war between Tesha and Blackman. Because Dowan did carry out a killing that he was told specifically not to do. Right. That when time Blackman tried reprimand him, he make him know to listen, Blackman is not my Don, Tesha my boss. Right. And just like that, after Chala lost him life, the one decides him not to talk. That is when people have to get forced to make a decision. Whoever side do not take, Tesha Miller or black man. The one, them are Jordan and them, and they take side with Tesha. Guess what? Sci-Fi started to hunt the one. Sci-Fi go down on the one baby mother yard and start to sleep on her roof. Days on end. But because the one already know about Sci-Fi, because they were all a part of one team, so them know how him operate, and them know say when Sci-Fi look for you, him just find somebody where when know your arm. If him know, for example, say you have a baby mother down the road and you love to steal that baby mother, him just wait for you down there. So the one end up don't go and baby mother no time at all. So Sci-Fi hunt him and I wait for him, and the one is not turning up. But by this point, black man had momentum on his side, right? Because Tesha Miller was very weakened, because enough of his premier 87s them were no longer around to help him fight this battle. From about late 2010 to about early 2012, Tesha Miller suffered some devastating losses when it comes on to some of his most ruthless 87s, right? The police then end up take out enough of them, or other 87s kill them off. So Tesha Miller did lose people like Nevada Hodges, who, well, he was behind that, but he lose people like J-Bod. He knows people like Roderick, Speedy was gone, Satan was also killed, people like Badfram, right? So enough of them man there who would have been the main resistance against black man, they were now gone, right? So even though Again, as I said, enough people tell that it's about late 2010, 2011, the split start. That isn't actually the real split, because remember, the original transition was not anything done by force. Blackman was the legitimate leader of Klant, right, because Tesha Miller handed it over to him. And he was calling the shots, even though people are losing their life here and there, and anybody who would have challenged Blackman, you know, he would get rid of them, right? But when the real war, when things get extremely hot, when Klansman, when Spanish Town did have two people, three people are dead every single day, that was triggered by a single event. That event was the death of Craig Miller. Now, you hear the last name and you can already tell. Craig Miller was Tesha Miller's brother. He had grown fed up of Blackman's style of leadership and decided to say, he might go start recruit someone, right, and they might go lock the place until Tesha Miller come back and take over the thing fully. When Blackman heard this, he decided this was totally unacceptable. So who did he send to get rid of Craig Miller? None other than Sci-Fi. Sci-Fi and Barber, them go down at Craig Yard and them wait for him, right? Typical Sci-Fi style, them lie down in the yard and wait for him hours on end until Craig come home, and as him come in the yard, the man them wet him up. It wasn't just Craig who lost his life that day, there was also a 17-year-old youth by the name of Oral Wright, right, who lost his life. So now, Tesha Miller's brother was dead, and he was killed under Blackman's order. As you can imagine, Tesha Miller was not happy. Tesha Miller felt extremely violated that something like this could happen, especially in a system where, in his mind, I'm the boss of. That right there took the Klansman war to an extreme level. That is when, like you said, two a day, three a day. When people from Spanish Town, remember that period, early 2015 onwards, that is when Spanish Town did hot like hell itself, right? People lay down on the ground, left, right, and center. Bus stop, March Penn Road, anywhere you go, Thompson Penn, anywhere you go, the man go for each other. Sci-Fi was one of the main people who was leading those attacks for Blackman's side. When I talk about Sci-Fi and French and them and they, right, Sub-Zero, right, Duck. That group of 87 helped to turn Spain into a complete ghost town. And what made things even worse for Tesha is that Blackman was managing to convert enough of Tesha's old soldiers to take side with him and even bring in new and very dangerous 87s, right? One of the strategies that Blackman used to convince enough people to switch on Tesha is good old cherry tricks. See, Blackman would tell the man him, say, listen, look how long Tesha run the system. I want to get $5,000 for shoot, man. Right, now I know enough people are here starting to themselves, what's the repeat about? $5,000 US? No. People in a Klansman, they are shoot people for $5,000. Right, if you get $10,000, you're lucky. Right, the low level 87s, they never like get much. Blackman come in and Blackman is like, listen, double this, triple that, so him end up buying out enough people, right? He was using the good old cherry tricks. Plus, he was presenting himself as more business-minded and was trying to say to the 87 them, listen, we could turn this thing into more of a money-making operation, right? At first, he wasn't really pushing the Wallypa kill, kill, kill. But within time, people started to realize that, hold on, Blackman actually loved the killing more than Tesha. Right? Blackman was just as ruthless, if not even worse, right? He was completely merciless. From somebody violate, they must be dead. And by this point, he felt untouchable, especially with people like Sci-Fi in the streets carrying out his operations, right? Sci-Fi was also linking with the next unit named Toulouse, and they were just going around hunting anybody who was against Blackman. So right then and there, Blackman felt untouchable. But slowly but surely, the thing started to unravel, because in January 2015, Toulouse lost his life. And then to make things worse, the real major blow came in May 2015, when Sci-Fi and Frenchie were killed. Two of Blackman's strongest soldiers. Now, who killed Sci-Fi and how did he lose his life? Check this out. Sci-Fi had got very, very comfortable, because by now, his reputation had preceded him. He was very feared amongst not just people on his side, but his rivals, police, once people hear the name Sci-Fi, them not take no check. Now, before I tell you how Sci-Fi lost his life in 2015, let me give you an interesting story as to how most of this could have been avoided, because in 2011, Sci-Fi came very close to being killed. Yes, police had the opportunity to kill Sci-Fi in 2011, and guess what happened? There was a shootout. There was a hell of a shootout between Sci-Fi and the police. Sci-Fi ended up running and jumping at the river. When the police them go to kill Sci-Fi, guess what? Them not a shot. The shootout lasted so long that everybody without a shot. So what the police them do? Them start to beat Sci-Fi. Them kick him and then beat him and then kick him and then beat him. I guess they're trying to kick him to death or something. Crowd start to draw, people start to ball, and Sci-Fi was speared. The police them end up after lock up Sci-Fi because they can't kill him, they're not on a shot. Then when them carry Sci-Fi go to jail, go through him to jail, he couldn't walk. For 2 days, Sci-Fi had to lay down at the same spot in the jail because he couldn't stand up on him 2 foot them. That's how badly they beat him up, right? People were saying, listen, that's the end of it. After this, them can't see Sci-Fi go back to badness because him learn him lesson now. Learn him lesson. As soon as Sci-Fi got better, he went right back doing what he always did. So, 2011, if a policeman did have just one shot left back, just one, this entire story would have been completely different. But I guess what is to be is supposed to be. And Sci-Fi was supposed to be a part of a bigger story. So now, let's go back to 2015. May 2015, when Sci-Fi is going to get killed. So Sci-Fi was chilling in a Brooklyn, right? He had gotten sloppy. Nobody never challenged him, right? Even though enough people know he should probably find him, nobody never stepped to him, right? He has this tendency to walk around a bulletproof vest. Yes, Sci-Fi had an official bulletproof vest walking around with, plus him rifle, plus him handgun. Nobody not test him. Sci-Fi went and gave his rifle to a youth named Polka Boy, right? Just give it to him for luck. When Sci-Fi gave Polka Boy the rifle, Sci-Fi was not aware that Polka Boy had switched. Polka Boy was linking with Dowan and the Mandy. So them send information to them to listen. Him give him rifle for luck and he asked him there. Sci-Fi left Brooklyn, right? And I go to collect the rifle. When him go collect the rifle from Polka Boy, two carload of man was waiting for him. Yes, not one, but two carload. The reason why so much of them come is because, as I said, Sci-Fi was feared. So no man like Spooky and Doe and them park up that the car and watch Sci-Fi and Frenchy, right? And as Sci-Fi wait for Polka Boy to bring back the rifle to come give him, Polka Boy sneak up on Sci-Fi and give him one in the head. So him end up losing life and him own a rifle with him, the Polka Boy, right? So as soon as Sci-Fi drop and the man in the car realize like one, them now start run down Frenchy, right? And start to wet up Frenchy, right? And then while some of them are run down Frenchy, the rest of them start disarm Sci-Fi because remember, he was walking around in his vest and him gun pan him. So man him take off the vest, take him gun off of him, right? And the next set of man them now run down Frenchy and I wet him up. There was a gully behind the yard at Indeso, Frenchy end up drop and stayed the whole night because he didn't have his phone, so he couldn't call nobody to come help him, and he stayed down there and bleed out. So you might be wondering, who is this Polka Boy? Of course you know, I'm gonna hook you up. Look at your screen right now. There he is. That is the man who killed Sci-Fi. That is the man who double-crossed Sci-Fi and gave him one in the head from his own rifle. Now, this same individual, Polka Boy, indeed end up carrying out an infamous killing of a man named Lenny. Right, Lenny was big in the system back in the day, right? But Lenny did say he retired from badness and him done with them thing there and end up start run a shop. Now, this youth, Polka Boy, did end up go kill Lenny. And there is an infamous video. People, it's one of the most extraordinary shootings they'll ever see. Lenny in at the shop. A sell like anybody, you know, him they be on the counter selling bread and this and that, and Polka Boy go for him, and you know, little opening by the in every shop, you have a little small door where them push the things them through, and in the so Polka Boy jump through half a body and shoot Lenny. Now the video, You want to see it? It's on politicswatch.com. By the time this video go live, that video will also be on the site. You can check it out. Now, people, please, everybody don't run over there at the same time and slow down the site completely, right? But you will see the same Polka Boy who end up kill Sci-Fi carry out that killing of Lenny, who was a top man in a clans. Right, as I said, it's one of the strangest things you will ever see. How the youth, the lens for the youth go through, right, to end up kill Lenny, right? And that same video is what sink him. In case you're wondering, where's Polka Boy now? Well, he's in prison because the whole thing was captured on film, face clear as day. So you can check out that video if you want. Now let's go back to Sci-Fi, because obviously by now Sci-Fi is gone. But you know, Black Man inside the clans wasn't going to make it slide like that, right? Because he was highly rated. And by this point, he was one of Black Man's top, if not the top killer, right? And to make things worse, Frenchie also lost his life. So Black Man took a huge loss in one night. Even though it wasn't until the following day, them find Frenchie body in the gully, right? Because they say he was running and it ended up dropping at the gully and just stayed there until him eventually pass off. So quite a few people end up losing their life in retaliation for what happened to Sci-Fi. There was even an infamous incident where a youth named Bram sent a voice note basically saying, listen, on our ball know about Sci-Fi, wait till this and wait till that. Well, the voice note getting at the wrong person hand. Guess who the voice note got to? The voice note went to a girl named Anarchy, and Anarchy made the clansman them hear it, and the clansman then go back go kill Bram. You wanna hear the spooky part of that? Anarchy is the cousin of Stacy and Shanna Lee. Those names ring a bell? Well, if you listen keenly to the videos I make, you should already pick it up. Stacy, as in the same Stacy from the Crab and the Charmian Rattray story. Yes, fair cousin. Play back the video, play back the voice note for the clansman name, make them hear Bram basically a gloat over what the Sci-Fi and the man name go back go kill Bram. It not finish yet. Guess what Bram is to Anarchy? Bram was her own brother. So her actions end up getting her own brother killed. Anarchy was sleeping with Sci-Fi. I know that's going to take a while for people to really figure out and scratch them head, but play it back 3 or 4 times. And trust me, when you get it, you'll realize how extraordinary that entire situation really was. So, like most Apex 87s, Sci-Fi luck had run out. Frenchie's luck had run out, right? So it's just interesting that Sci-Fi survived so many police shootout, right? Half a dog, and Sci-Fi used to get into it all the time, right? As me say, them beat him, broke him up all the time. People that say police that killed Sci-Fi, when it turns out it was his own fellow 87s, right? He made a crucial mistake of trusting somebody who was around him in an organization that is known for being friend killers, right? Nobody that kill clans more than clans. One Order versus clansman is a joke compared to clansman versus clansman. When the Tesha and Blackman beef got hot, that was the biggest war of attrition Spanish Town has ever seen, right? And to be honest, even now, the organization has never fully recovered. Remember, people, the biggest damage that was done to clans is from the 87s them killing off each other, and the fact say about 50 or 60 of them are currently behind bars waiting for trial. Klansman is still a deadly organization, you know. Don't get it twisted. Them can still go for people, them can still fling on people, right? Right now, them are cause a bug of problem over River Valley, right? So don't get it twisted. But rest assured, you see, if so many of them never drop out, you see, if J-Bad, Hodges, Sci-Fi, Frenchie, Toulouse, right, the Bad from, if those men were still alive now and were going at it now, during the time of YouTube, and I had to be covering these cases, all these beheadings, all these them are flinging man head over yasso and flinging foot over yasso, if these things were happening right now, trust me, YouTube would be hot like fire. Like, think about the bone waste on these videos. You see the traction with them videos they get? It would be a complete child's play compared to what would be getting put out if the J-Bad and the Hadjis and the Cyphers were going at it, right? So the timing as to when Tesha lose no for him soldier them and when Cypher and them and the staff drop out, in the end, it worked out the best for Spanish Town and Jamaica. Because trust me, if we had a situation where somebody like James Hines was going at it against somebody like a Cypher, that would be like a real life Freddy versus Jason. And I don't think Jamaica is ready to deal with something like that. We're having a bad enough time dealing with 87s like Bunways, much less them caliber of criminals. Eh? Right, so people, that's it for today. Right, Sci-Fi, real name, Orion Malcolm, the man who you can argue his killings help put and establish black man as the leader of Klansman. Patreon squad, big up on yourself. PIA, you don't know, more life. Bless.